turned on a dime and you saw this opportunity to call attention to an important issue, not putting him in the, well, why did you do that?
No,
don't you know better than, no. But it's a perfect example of what everybody needs to think about, being careful and being safe. And that's exactly what I would hope everybody will eventually feel comfortable doing. It's not something that you're born with. I think the more time you spend in the classroom, and I think some people might be more able to do that just because of your personality, but that's a great example of how I think everybody needs to make this experience their own, be attuned to the kids, what's going on in their lives, and you know, I often tell the new volunteers too that, you know, we want you to read a story and then have a discussion or do some kind of extension activity after the book to bring that story into their real world, because that's what's going to really have value, learning value for them. So I heard Gary saying earlier, Gary is a photographer, semi-professional, I mean, he could be professional, but he's a doctor, so whatever. But anyway, he takes amazing wildlife photos. Where were you?
We've done some at the zoo here and some in South Africa.
South Africa on safari. So he brings in his photographs, and then I heard you say something about you asked the child, have you ever seen this animal, and what was their response?
Well, they frequently, if they've seen them, they've seen them at the zoo.
Right.
And so we talk about that, or we talk about the Forest Park, or other things that are accessible to everybody.
So if you're reading the Eric Carle story from head to toe, you can't bring in a gorilla. You know, hi kids, this is a gorilla. You can't do that. But how can you make that story relate to their real life? When I do it, I take in photographs that I've just downloaded off the internet because
right.
I don't have
right.
you at my house. But that's how I do it. I'll say, has anybody ever seen this? You know, this is what the artist thinks this animal should look like, or what he wanted this animal to look like. And this is what it would look like if you see it in the zoo, something like that.
We always had a science conference. We have several science books about animals, especially. They're appropriate for the age.
Right.
2 pages of explanation of, you know, the metamorphosis of a frog or
right.
whatever. You know, and so we do a little science lesson along with our reading if we have a book about a certain kind of an animal. I don't know about goats.
Any way you can bring in different aspects of real life and things that they may not have looked at in a certain way, I think is great. So back to this sample, these sample sessions. The first session, I hope everyone begins their session with some kind of greeting song. You know, my greeting song is, hello, how are you? Hello, how are you? Hello, how are you? How are you today? I'm not a singer, as you can tell. But the kids don't notice that. The kids notice that the first thing I do after I smile at them is I start singing. And by beginning my session with singing, it immediately sets the tone for the next 30 minutes. This is going to be fun. This is not going to be, you know, scary. And this is not going to be, she's going to be asking too much of me. And will I live up to it? This is fun. Because, as I've said this before, you know, unless you're in an opera, there's not a lot of angry singing going on. So just by starting out with a simple ditty, you set the tone that we're going to have fun together today. I know you're all using your name tags, and it's so important. I know some people think it takes too long to distribute the name tags every time. Even if you don't have the children wear the name tags, please use them almost like flashcards to hold them up and let kids get that practice seeing their written name in upper and lowercase letters so that they are able to find their cubby when they get to kindergarten. And not only will they learn to recognize their own name, but they will begin to recognize each other's names. This is how reading begins.
Sheila?
Yes?
I have a horrible time learning the kids' names, not because they're them, but because I am anybody. But I've got a little system that's helping me at the beginning. she'll help me. And I'm lucky enough that they all sit in pretty much the same row each time I go. This wouldn't work for a lot of people, but if they've got a system where they sit somewhere, I've got the little chart, and at night, I can look at the chart and figure out who's who, and then it helps me fit the name.
I've actually taken pictures of the kids with their name tag on, because, well, and I always say this is not, I will not publish this, this will not be given to anybody else, this is strictly for me, and I've been told no, which of course then I don't do it. But I am a person who needs to see your face and your name written down in order for me to try to even begin to learn names. Yes?
I wanted to also say that the name tags are not a problem for me. I went through them and I'm learning the kids' names. They play with them and tear them and twist them, and every session I have to stop and untwist, or the teacher has to untwist, because Jacob has it like this.
Right.
It's a noose now.
With the twos, I don't even use them.
Yeah, I actually got stick-on labels, and I put different colors, like my two-year-olds are the reds. Mm-hmm. I print their name real big on my computer. I know not everybody can do this. And I have, like, you know, at a business, like a Office Max or something, where I have a roll, so I can, you know, print a whole bunch of them, and they stick them on. So I stick them on them now.
Again.
They like it. They're different colors. My three-year-olds are green. My four and five-year-olds are blue.
Make it your own.
And they love it, so I just wanted to bring it up, that if anybody else is having trouble with the yarn turning into a noose, which happens every time.
You use the
not to get it off.
Sarah is saying she went out with her own dollars and purchased the Clippy one.
And they were, you know, I got 360 labels. It was on sale. It was $4.99.
Yeah.
And just happened, you know, I've got a computer with a printer and the ink.
If you are able and willing to invest your own dollars in that, we as an organization can't afford to do that.
Yeah,
which is why we are still with the cardstock ones. But again,
make it
your own.
Do it
however you want. But having that name, having that practice of seeing their names is really, really key. Here.
I use the blue name tags that Ready Readers has, which is a nice card index. Mm-hmm. And I use fabric. I strip fabric, and I happen to have wool that I can strip. And so it doesn't cut into them, and it really stays. So I punch two holes on each side, and then I make knots so that the fabric stays. And somehow it just lays there.
I noticed that when the twisting happens, it's not necessarily because it's itching them, it's because it's sitting right here in that
spiral.
Right.
Or it's in your mouth.
I did start, when I started using stickers though, that went down because they stopped pulling and tugging on them, because if you break it after your stickers are on, you have to start over with a clean card.
Well, Jacob puts his sticker on his forehead,
yeah.
But I do see his name.
That's
so
not
some
surprising.
Of them will take it off. We've got an agreement now. Jacob can wear it on his face.
Right, you know.
On his little forehead.
I laminate.
It does help me understand.
Yeah,
laminate can help.
Whatever way works for you, go for it. Just really know that there is an educational reason that we want you to be using these name tags and having kids have the opportunity to see their written names every single week. So after you distribute your name tags, some people like to do a stretch and breathe. Again, if you have attended last year's emotions workshop, that can be something just as simple as everybody standing up, stretching up, maybe to the side, things like that, maybe reaching down. Anytime you can work in cross body, crossing the midline kind of activities is good, because it helps kids align their left and right brains into working together. So you could just do something simple like this. Oh, I'm gonna tickle my fingers. I'm gonna reach over and tickle these fingers. So any of these crossing the midline kind of actions are good. You could do those windmill things. Doesn't have to be a 10-minute ordeal. It can just be something 30 seconds where you're standing up and taking a deep breath, reaching up. I always say, if you want to have a successful 30-minute session, it really helps to begin from a place of calm. Mm-hmm. And because they're 2 and 3 and 4 and 5, calm is probably not a state that they're in when you get them. And And so we have to help them understand how to achieve that. And deep breathing is a simple technique that we can teach them, stretching and doing some deep breaths. Our simple techniques we can teach them that hopefully the teacher will notice we're doing and may incorporate into his or her part of the day. But more importantly, we're empowering the kids to realize that they can do this themselves. If you repeat this every time, they will start internalizing it, feeling stressed out. This is how I can take care of that.
Is that the belly breath technique?
Uh-huh.
Because I do that with my kids.
Well, belly breathing is where they actually put their hands on their...
Yeah, I have them put their hands there. And a little girl yesterday said, you know, Jimmy needs the belly button. She calls it the belly button breathe.
Right.
It works.
I've had kids pick up on this in as little as 2 weeks. Yes. And when a kid is poking them during a reading session, I'll see them close the eyes go,
yes.
It's amazing, and these kids need to feel in control. So much of their life is out of their control, which causes them stress. So if we can help empower them to feel like they can have control over how they feel, that's huge. That's just huge. And it's going to free up their brain to be able to actually take in information. Then you read your book one, you have your discussion or your related activity that you're already doing. That's a great time, I think, to do a nursery rhyme or a finger play in between book one or book two. Again, then you have discussion and collect your name tags and goodbyes. Another twist on that is after you're greeting and distributing your name tags, do a finger play then before you get into the reading of the books. You know, that could be the time that becomes, oh, we're going to do a rhyme and a finger play, and then she's going to read the book. Remember, we want to develop some kind of routine where they can anticipate sort of what's coming next. Again, that's going to make them feel more comfortable in the environment. It's going to allow them to adapt their behaviors to what they know your expectations are for the next thing in line. And this might be a routine that works with your group. So greeting, name tags, nursery rhyme or finger play, then just do we all know this take five breathing that I've demonstrated before? again, just another deep breathing exercise that can help them achieve calm before you start asking them to sit still for 20 minutes. You know, I say, okay, everybody, show me five. And then I say, we're gonna climb the mountain and go back down. When we're climbing the mountain, we're going to take deep breaths in through our nose like this. Let me see you do it. I saw some of you. Okay. And then when we go down the mountain, we're going to blow it out through our mouths. So everybody, show me five. Here we go. Up the mountain. In. Down. In. And make sure you're doing it slowly. Because if you're rushing them, you're getting them to hyperventilate. Not really the outcome we're looking for, okay? So keep in mind, deep breathing should be a slow process. And you also don't want your kids puking in the middle of it. I try to avoid puking and bleeding whenever possible. So after you get them to take a few deep breaths, and again, once you do this a couple of times, if this becomes a part of your routine, you don't even have to say anything. You will do this, and they will automatically do this and this. And they're ready. I think the more routine you can give them and the more ownership they can take of this 30-minute reading session, it's going to change how they think about everything that you're doing. So, again, keep this in mind. This is a very simple technique, and they catch on really quickly.
So so doing that, it's not necessarily because when we did the session on calming down and so forth, and we talked them, and I was actually naive. I was very naive, and I was quite shocked to learn that these kids really do need to calm down. And one little boy said, oh, when I go to bed at night, and I call my mom, and I can hear gunshots, and, you know, I mean, my gosh, you know, I didn't, you know, I was very naive. But in spite of that, these kids for 6 years,
But it's not a part of our everyday life, but it is theirs.
We talked about the breathing, and they, and I thought they really, really took it on board. But then this business then is like an everyday thing.
This is just, when you say to children, or when adults say to kids, calm down. Okay, kid's having a meltdown.
Yeah.
Well, yelling at them, not really a great, you know, idea, in my opinion. They need help. That child is in crisis right now. They're not doing it because it feels good to have a meltdown. They're doing it because their little body has so much anxiety in it, it has to come out somehow. And that's how it's coming out right now. So they don't need to be told to go sit in a corner and feel bad about, you know, your outburst. They need us, as the caring adults in their lives, to teach them how to deal with that. Oh, that feels awful, doesn't it? It feels so awful to have all that inside. I'm going to show you a way that you can get it out and you'll feel better.
So you're suggesting you do this take five when you can see that there's a percentage of the class is really...
I actually think the Take Five breathing is a wonderful tool to use every week, even if no one, in fact, it's better to introduce this technique when no one is in crisis. Because the time for them to really take it in and understand, when they're in crisis, their thinking part of their brain is shut off. They're reacting. They're not, you know, they're not acting in a thoughtful manner, because they're acting from kind of the primal part of their brain. It's a fight, flight, or freeze mode. So the time to teach them these techniques is in a calm setting where everybody's having fun, where you've set the tone by singing and they trust you and they're happy to be with you. That's when the learning happens, okay? So if we can teach them these techniques in a calm setting where they feel safe with us, they know we care about them, then when they get to that place, they'll be able to pull this tool out of their toolbox and use it. That's the idea.
It's nice because then it's visual. The book is great.
And, you know, you feel the sensation of your finger tracing on your skin. So it's a multi-sensory activity.
So it occurred to me, yes, I mean, just as you're talking now, that probably, let's say some boy's in bed and his mama isn't coming, so it'd probably be good for him to do it with his hand better mm-hmm. than just saying,
right.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Right.
It's tactile and visual.
Right.
It's every time.
So there are, this talks about brain breaks in here. And brain breaks is another sheet. It basically talks about the need for kids to get up and move and kind of refocus their brain activity and energy. So I'm going to leave this for you all to kind of look through on your own. I don't want to sit and read everything to you. But I just kind of, in a quick overview, there are reasons, educational reasons, why we ask you to do the things that we ask you to do. And I know for people who have been doing this for 20 years, they might say, well, why are we doing all this touchy-feely stuff? I'm just going in to read a book. You might think you're just going in to read a book, but really what you're doing is so much more. And we're just trying to help give you some tips and clues to make what you're providing for the kids even more powerful for them now and in the future. And without further ado, I would like to introduce our special guest. Some of you may already know her. Carol Kaplan Liss was in charge of the preschool program that my older children attended. In fact, it was that program where I first started teaching preschool. And as I said, she was a great influence.